പറഞ്ഞോ വിനസ് സാറേ പറഞ്ഞോ.
വിനസ് സർ,
ഏ അൺമ്യൂട്ട്. ആ ഹലോ, ആ നേരത്തെ
സർ അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ആണ്, പറഞ്ഞോളൂ, സംസാരിച്ചോ.
ആ ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ. ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് ഓൾ. ടുഡേ ഈസ് ദ മോസ്റ്റ് ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ഡേ ഫോർ അസ് എസ്പെഷ്യലി ഓഫീസ് ബെയറേഴ്സ് ഓഫ് അയ്യപ്പ ട്രിവാൻഡ്രം, ബിക്കോസ് ടുഡേ ഈസ് ദ ബർത്ത് ഡേ ഓഫ് അവർ ദ ഇ മാൻ ഓഫ് അവർ അയ്യപ്പ ട്രിവാൻഡ്രം,
ദാറ്റ്
ഇസ് പ്രവീൺ്റെ ബർത്ത്ഡേ ആണ്. അപ്പൊ ആ രീതിയിൽ നമുക്ക് വളരെ ഒരു ആഘോഷപരമായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു സീരീസ് ഓഫ് പ്രോഗ്രാം ആണെന്ന്. അതിൽ ഏറ്റവും ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് എന്നുള്ളത് നമുക്ക് ഇന്നത്തെ സ്പീക്കേഴ്സും വളരെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻ്റ് ആണ്. കാരണം നമ്മുടെ പ്രവീണിൻ്റെ ബർത്ത്ഡേ ആയിട്ട് തന്നെ നമുക്ക് നല്ലൊരു നല്ല രണ്ട് സ്പീക്കേഴ്സാണ് നമുക്കുള്ളത്, എലിസബത്ത് മാഡം, ഡോക്ടർ ഷാനവാസും. എനിവേ, താങ്ക് യു വെരി മച്ച് ഫോർ അക്സെപ്റ്റിംഗ് അവർ ഇൻവിറ്റേഷൻ ഫോർ ടുഡേയ്സ് സ്പീച്ച്, എസ്പെഷ്യലി മാഡം ആൻഡ് ഡോക്ടർ ഷാനവാസ്. And at the same time, I wish all the best and many, many happy returns for the day to Dr. Praveen also. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod, sir. I now request Elizabeth Madam to start her presentation. Over to Elizabeth Madam. Madam?
200, I...
Hi everyone, respected seniors and all IAPNs, happy birthday to Dr. Praveen, and my special thanks and appreciation for the trios, Dr. Bennett, Dr. Priya and Dr. Praveen and Dr. Riyas and all of you, the way you take care of IAP. So I welcome you to the topic today, that is challenges and bottleneck in infant feeding. And I have making the disclosure, the cases discussed are based on the Nutrition Education Program updated 2020 under the Central IAP Action Plan. My screen is not moving.
Madam. ഷെയർ സ്ക്രീൻ പ്രസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട് മാഡം.
ന്യൂ ഷെയർ വരുവ
മാഡം, ഒന്ന് ക്ലോസ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് റീഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്താൽ മതി. ഒന്നും കൂടെ ഷെയർ സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്താൽ മതി മാഡം.
I'll do it. It's not moving.
Second.
The slides are not moving.
Madam, madam, mate, nammade normal view il ittitte move cheyan pattu nu nokka madam. Full screen onnu maattite. Full screen maattite. Nalla madam.
സോ എവറി ന്യൂ ബോൺ ബേബി ഹു ഇസ് ബോൺ ലൈക് ദിസ് വി വുഡ് ലൈക്ക് ദ ബേബി ടു ഗ്രോ അപ് ഹാപ്പി ആൻഡ് ഹെൽത്തി ലൈക് ദിസ് ബട്ട് സം ഓഫ് ദം എൻഡ് അപ് ലൈക് വിത്ത് മാൽ ന്യൂട്രിഷൻ ആൻഡ് സം ഓഫ് ദം ബിക്കം വെരി ഒബീസ് ഓൾസോ സോ WHO പൊസിഷൻ പേപ്പർ says that if a newborn is denied breastfeeding in the first hour, there is a 33% higher chance of dying. And if the newborn is denied one day breastfeeding, there is 200% chance of dying. And we know that fuel deficiency in utero and early part of life leads to early nutrition programming, leading to the Barker hypothesis through the thrifty phenotype. And fuel excess in utero also will in utero and postnatally will lead to early onset of metabolic syndrome. And another interesting feature report is that introduction of complementary feeds before 4 months of age leads to increased risk of obesity. With this background, let us go. And I'm very happy that BFHI has been revamped in 2018, and this set of 10 new guidelines are very important, and if you can have this with you, it will be very helpful. It is very practical and very with lot of illustrations. And when we think of the complementary feeding, we first, what is coming to our mind is the bridge that was made by the jellyfish. That is the bridge that was made by jellyfish, that is between the liquid diet to the solid diet. The mother has to make a bridge, that is the semi-solid, and this should be strengthened on three pillars. One is continue breastfeeding till the baby is safe till 2 years of age, and second is make it strong with a protein from
between the liquid diet to the solid diet
and non-vegetarian diet. And now we have added the safety net. What is the safety net? That is small frequent feeds through Akshaya Patra concept or the sunshine of group eating or supplementary feeding from the Anganwadis. Now we go to some cases. The first case is, as usual, a primary mother, no risk factors, but LSCS is done. So when the mother is had LSCS, 1 hour she was in the recovery room, and after that the baby is shifted to the room. After the mother and the baby are now together, and there is no record as to whether the baby was given breastfeed earlier. But now after 1 hour, the mother is under sedation and the baby is sleeping, and the granny says there is no milk, as usual. And now the nurse sees that the granny is feeding honey. So what is the role of prelacteal feeds? It has no benefits except for adverse impact on early initiation of the colostrum, breastfeeding, exclusive breastfeeding, and increased chances for contamination. And now the mother and the baby, the granny are all convinced that we need not give the prelacteal feed. But now the granny is telling the baby does not know how to latch, and the mother is now becoming very anxious. So how to ensure good latch? And we must capitalize on this latch score with 10 points. How the baby is latching on to the breast? Is it an effective sucking and swallowing? What is the type of the nipple? What is the comfort level of the mother? How the hold? Does she need, can she hold the baby herself or she needs help? And we always do the Apgar score, and we know what importance we, what significance we give to that, practically done. But we have to do the latch score. This is excellent, and any score less than 7 needs help. Now I have trained the postgraduates to do this in all the mothers and those coming with malnutrition. And we record the first cry, the first meconium, first urine. But we have to start doing recording the first feed. Then it becomes a routine. Everybody will be anxious, or everybody will be empowered that the baby should be fed within the first hour. And we have to sing a song of stops, as the neonatologists say, that is sensorium, temperature, oxygenation, perfusion, and sugars. If anything is wrong with this, you have to act according to the NNF or AAP guidelines. Now the mother is asking how much time I should take for feeding, and how many times I should feed. Is it 2 or 3 hourly feeding? Now this is because the mother is not empowered to understand the hunger cues. Let us see the hunger cues. Look at this. This is the order in which the hunger cues come. The mouth is open. Now the head is turning, stretching, hand to mouth, and then crying. So if the hunger cues come in this sequence, and crying is the last expression of hunger, but babies do cry for something else. If the mother can understand this, she can be empowered to do demand feeding. Okay. Now the mother is doing demand feeding. Now we have empowered her. But she's asking how to increase the milk. Shall I take any galactagogue? To my mind, enough water is the best galactagogue. Galactagogues may be having some effect, mostly placebo effect. We have to instill hope and confidence in the mother so that the oxytocin reflex will work. And we have to capitalize on the prolactin reflex. How do we do that? Prolactin is secreted after a feed to produce the next feed. So if feeding is not given or is delayed, less prolactin will come. And night feed has to be continued so that milk is secreted, prolactin is more secreted at night. So these are the two things. Now we have to have an understanding of the physiology of lactogenesis. Lactogenesis 1 starts as early as 16 to 20 weeks of gestation, empowering the mammary gland for synthesis of milk. And then lactogenesis 2 is the immediate postpartum. It is the very difficult 30 to 40 hours. It may be delayed, further delayed, if there is lack of confidence in cesarean sections and certain other hormone problems. So lactogenesis 2, 10 to 40 ml of colostrum only may be coming, that is scanty. And then comes the copious milk production. And then comes the lactogenesis 3, this is maintenance of the copious mature milk production, that is the emptying is the stimulus for milk, more milk production. And we can see that there is an autocrine or a local control for this lactogenesis 3 phase. Now, the second case scenario, infertility treatment and low birth weight twin babies 1.2 and 1.3. And the mother is unable to hold the babies in the cradle position because they are very small. And she doesn't know when to feed, why my baby is crying. So first we have to teach her the hunger cues as we did for the other mother. Any out of the box solutions you can think of? Yes, we have to go for alternate positions like cross cradle or football. So this is the cradle position. The mother is holding same hand on the side of feeding. This is cross cradle, opposite hand. This is football. And this is twins. Either from either side, the football is coming and they are resting on a pillow. And this is the sideline position. This is also important. In one case, I am referring to this. So look at this. And this is the Australian hold. So for twins, we can advise this or the cross cradle method. Now, one mother is coming with retracted nipple. She's baby is unable to latch, and this is detected on day 2. So how to help? We could have detected it earlier. Do we have any out-of-the-box solutions? Yes, sometimes areola feeding can work. And what test to be performed? That is the protractility test. See this one. Usually the baby is in the supine position. Here the baby is in the prone position, and here the baby can latch on to the areola. So this is some out of the way solution for a retracted nipple. And then hold also can be modified. Usually we go for the C hold or the V hold, sandwich hold, but you can go for the U hold. How do we do the U hold? See the cross cradle with the U hold. When the nipple is small or retracted, this can work. And another is the baby-led breastfeeding. See, breast crawl. The baby is crawling and is attaching to the areola. So the protractility test should have been done in the third trimester by the obstetrician or the A&M. And how do we do it? Try to protrude it. And in grade 1, it remains protruded for some time and will retract after some time. In grade 2, it will protrude temporarily and immediately will retract. And 3 will not retract. So we have to, there will be some troubleshooting. The mother may have to express milk, that is circular movements around the, on the areola, then stretching movements to 4 sides, and then holding it up and down, and then the mother can express. Or she can use a breast pump. And sometimes when, because of these reasons, milk supply has been stopped, we can relactate, make her relactate by the supplementary suckling technique. That is, the supplement is routed through the areola and the nipple, and the baby is full to suck. But suckling will increase the prolactin and the oxytocin reflex. And this is the double syringe technique connected by the rubber tubing from our IV fluid set. One with piston, that is the reservoir. The other will go to the, without piston, will go to the mother. Now, mother with cracked nipple. Usually the cracked nipple may be because of candidiasis. There may be associated candidiasis also, and nipple sucking is another reason for this. So we have to apply some oil and high milk on the cracked nipple and treat the candidiasis locally as well as in the mother's, the baby's mouth. And if there is a if it is recurrent, persistent, or if there is a history of persistent aching pain deep into the breast of the mother, she may need systemic fluconazole also. And so advise her not to use clothed breast parts and wash the towels, bras, etc. in hot soapy water and air dry, and apply clotrimazole mouth pain to the baby. Now, the fifth case, that is the mother is coming with fullness of breast and it is extremely painful and she is running temperature. So how are you going to help? Is it full breast or engorged breast? That is the first thing we will have to find out. If it is full breast, it is hot, heavy, milk is flowing and there is no fever. So our mother is having, there is pain and there is fever. So it is not a full breast, it is an engorged breast. So how do we tackle that? In engorged breast, removal of milk has to be done. So if the milk will flow, we can make the baby to suckle. Otherwise, we can make her to express. Suppose expressing is very painful, no milk is coming, we'll have to stimulate the oxytocin reflex. That is, we have to put warm compress, warm shower, and massage her back, her neck and back, and massage the breast lightly, and we'll have to stimulate and then get it expressed. And after expression or suckling the baby, a cold compress has to be put on the breast, and also instill confidence in her. Tell her that she will soon be able to breastfeed comfortably so that the oxytocin reflex will work. Now, a mother with breast abscess, we may have to give, and we will have to give antibiotics, IND if needed, continue to feed from the opposite side. Milk flow from the affected side may stop because of local effect of fill. What is fill? It is the feedback inhibitor of lactation. If no emptying is happening on the opposite side, the opposite breast also may produce the fill, and that is because of the, you can recollect the lactogenesis 3 with the autocrine or local control. Oxytocin is working, prolactin is working, still milk supply can be cut off locally. Now, NICU baby is not able to feed because of RDS. What are the options? Teach the mother to express and give to the baby. But suppose the baby is having abdominal distension, associated NEC, etc. EBM is also not permitted. So what to do? We can give the option to donate breast milk and sustain lactation. Refer her to breast milk bank, that is Comprehensive Lactation Management Center is the new name for the breast milk bank. Now, forceful leg down. One mother recently came to me and said, my baby is choking and milk is flowing like a jet. That can happen sometimes. It is a temporary phenomenon. So what the mother will have to do is she will have to put the hand and fingers to slow down and allow the excess milk to flow onto a cloth. And in this case, side lying position of feeding is also good. So that is what I said. I showed the positions earlier. Now a baby is discharged. Third day was discharged, and eighth day a baby is refusing feeds. So we have to evaluate thoroughly. It can be something simple from blocked nose to a serious infection. It can be inborn errors of metabolism. It can be latching problem. It can be anxiety, or it can be baby-led weaning from the breast. Some babies do that usually around 1 year of age. So these are the problems that has to be addressed. Now, a baby is discharged on day 3 and brought back at 6 weeks. And at 6 weeks, we expect at least 1 kilogram more. That is, in the first week, there is no weight gain, but then almost 5 weeks of effective weight gain. So 200 grams per week, 5 into 200,000. So we expected 2.3 to become 3.3, but this baby is having only 2.5. Weight gain is not adequate. Now, most probably it may be a congestive cardiac failure because cold sweats are there, baby is pausing, and it became symptomatic around 6 weeks. So we have to refer and investigate. So all the organic causes we'll have to think of here, plus decreased milk production. In cases of retained placenta, I said lactogenesis 2 does not go to lactogenesis 3. Severe PPH, pituitary damage, syndrome, pseudoephedrine, then depression in the mother. And in 1 in 1,000 USA mothers, they have reported hypoplastic breast, a tubular or a conical breast, which is widespread more than 1.5 centimeters. So these are rare conditions. Now, COVID mother, any contraindication. All guidelines, what we say, are liable to change. As Dr. Shija says, these are live documents about COVID. New data may be coming. So as far as we know now, through breast milk, it is not transmitted. So mother can feed, but mother will have to observe hand hygiene and wear N95 mask, take droplet precautions, clean the breast and the upper abdomen with soap. And then suppose the mother has to be in isolation. She has to be in isolation if she is febrile. So febrile for 72 hours, isolation is gone. No respiratory symptoms, no isolation. And two swabs are negative more than 24 hours, isolation is gone. So till isolation is gone, if a mother is unwilling to feed directly or is under isolation, EBM can be collected and the baby can be fed by a healthy healthcare worker. And this is the document 7th May I referred. This is the same decision tree that was given. But there is a lot of knowledge practice gap. See the report from Rotak. They delivered a baby by LSCS and the infant will be kept on formula feed for 2 weeks so that she does not contact the infection from the mother. But you know, Mumbai Sion Hospital says they had 100 mothers COVID with babies. All of them are breastfeeding, taking all the precautions. So now coming to complementary feeding, look at Mithil. He was started semi-solids like mashed rice at 4 months. And then he refused with tongue thrust. So mother tried cow's milk, he was not accepting. And what happened to Mithil and his curve is going flat now. And that is because it was a too early introduction. The tongue thrust will go only by 6 months. And if the tongue thrust is there, you will have to continue to feed and then the tongue thrust will go away or put the feed into the cheek of the baby. And then with the tongue thrust, they will take it to the right to the mouth. So that was the problem with Mithil, but the mother, nobody counseled the mother. So there is growth faltering. Look at Sarah, she is 8 months old and at 4 months, around 5 months or so, mother thought milk is not sufficient, so she stopped and she started giving very dilute gruel. And what happened? Growth faltering is coming. So we must know what is the stomach capacity. We are taught that the stomach capacity is 30 cc per kg, but if you go to the SAM module, it is said that start with 11 ml per kg, maximum go up to 22 ml per kg. So we can only feed 20 or 22 ml per kg. And so based on the weight of the baby. And the rest is for the digestive juice and the air and all. So the food has to be isodense or energy dense. And you know that breast milk 70 calories per 100 ml. And most of the complementary feed should be giving 100 calories per 100 gram or 100 ml. If it is watery dilute formula, it will only give 30 kilocalories per 100 grams or 100 ml. So we have to increase the calorie density. How do we do that? Make it very thick. It should not fall away from the spoon. And add oil, ghee, coconut milk or coconut, jaggery and malted food. And then make it very energy dense so that 100 ml will give 100 kilocalories. And how do you make amylase rich food? All of us are now experts in making the microgreens, so we know how to do it. Here up to this stage, so germinate, then de-vegetate, sun dry or shallow fry up to 70 degree till that it starts free flow. And then powder and keep it in a container. And whenever any gruel is prepared, at the end of the cooking, when you are switching off the your fire, add 2-3 spoons of the amylase rich powder. We won't make the whole meal with amylase rich powder, amylase rich food, because it is not very tasty. There should be variety for the baby. And how to ensure fiber? And the fiber requirement is age in years plus 5 grams for the baby. So if you can give 2 small fruits like this, 4 grams fiber is given. If you give a 1 whole fruit like this, 4 grams is given. And one tuber will give 4 gram of fiber and 50 gram of green leafy vegetable. So if you can take two of these combinations, 8 gram for a 3-year-old baby can be met. And now at 6 months we start the feeding. It is 1 to 2 times, and whatever you start should be started in the morning. It is a porridge, it is a thick porridge, it is initially a cereal like ragi, then a cereal pulse, and then we will go for the vegetable and the fruit. And 7 to 8 months non-vegetarian items, because by 8 months taste buds will come, so the baby should be used to that. And they are super tasters, because taste buds per square centimeter is more for them. Our taste buds are far away because our tongue grew bigger, and so they are super tasters. So if you start giving them more salty or more sugary food, they will always demand that. There is no need to add extra salt or sugar till 1 year of age, and then 9 to 11 months, and 3 times we can feed. And 9 to 11 months, you can a variety of chopped, mashed food, and baby would like to touch them. Allow them to get the touch of that. And 3 meals plus 1 snack. And by 1 year, empower to family pot feeding, finger food, and 5 meals other than breast milk can be given. And so what is anticipatory nutrition and growth counseling? In fact, we are not doing that. That is why our children are falling into the pit of malnutrition during this bottleneck period of complementary feeding. Complementary feeding should be a responsive complementary feeding in a media-free zone, media-free time, with a comfortable seating. Baby should have a seating. Nowadays, mothers don't care. They show the TV, they do this and that, everywhere they start feeding. And a toddler should be given 5 food groups, 5 colors, 5 times. And by 1 year, I said baby should be empowered to family pot feeding, and we should capitalize on the rainbow revolution with 7 colors. What are the colors? The first 4 colors, Jor, green, yellow, orange, red, will represent the vegetables and the fruit and the 50% of a day's food. And then the 5th color is brown, that is whole grain or multigrain and the roots and tubers. And the 6th color is purple, that is for protein, maybe pulses or non-vegetarian items. And the last 7th color is white, that is dairy or milk and milk products. No child should have neuroglycopenia. So breakfast should not be missed. And we should learn all the labels. Anything more than 20% is high. Trans fat, everything will be written there. We'll have to read it and then learn. And the energy drinks, just to give 10 gram of protein, we may be giving them 50 to 60% of sugar. That is why I say you should read the labels. Now, the real challenges in infant feeding, I must say, is one is BFHI is supposed to look after everything, but only 2 to 5 days of hospital stay is there for a baby. So how can BFHI take care of breastfeeding till 2 years of age? Then there is no hospital visit for the baby after 3.5 months till 9 months. And from 9 months to 15 months also, there is no visit. So this is Rajasthan government which made this decision in 2018. No discharge from the hospital if woman is unable to breastfeed after delivery. I must say hats off to Dr. Shobha Kumar, who always says that even if it is the baby is going to be adopted and taken to the social justice department, Ammathottil, she will say that the Aya will have to come and stay with the baby and see how the baby is fed. Then she should be convinced that the caretaker can feed or the mother can feed. Then only she will discharge. But this will create a lot of stress for the administrators like Dr. Santosh Kumar and the obstetricians who want to discharge all the babies immediately. And this MA program, central government program, never percolated to our state or in the south. What is MA program? Enabling the mother to give her mother's absolute affection to the baby. That is MA, mother's absolute affection. We should have create awareness creation, community intervention and participation, monitoring. The employers should know that breastfeeding has to be, exclusive breastfeeding has to be given for 6 months. Creches has to be provided, etc. Now, because our topic is challenges in infant feeding, I am putting forward to the IAP that there should be a mandatory IAP endorsed checkup at 6 months and 1 year to give anticipatory nutrition and growth counseling. Now I am in the private sector, we are doing it. Every baby has a checkup at 6 months. So we see them, their growth, we give them the advice regarding the complementary feeding and also discuss about the influenza vaccine at that time. And at 1 year, all of them ritualistically come and we will tell them about the growth, about what family pot feeding and the rainbow revolution, all the colors are to be included, etc. And also discuss about the typhoid and the hepatitis A vaccine. So that is my plea. I hope that the Trivandrum branch will take it up with the state branch and EB members can take it up with the central branch also. So I'm ending here with an introspection. Are we committed to tackle the challenges and bottleneck in infant feeding? Thank you very much for the patient listening.
Thank you, madam, for the excellent talk. As usual, very clear and lucid. Now we'll move on to the second talk, which is also on a very common topic that we all face on a daily basis, on acute bronchiolitis. We have Professor Shanawas A, head of the Department of Pediatrics, Alappuzha Medical College here to talk on the topic. I would also like to welcome our state president and Narayanan sir and our secretary Bala sir, who's also here. Now I invite Shanawas sir to start the talk.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you're audible. You can share the screen.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So, good evening to all. First of all, happy birthday to the birthday man, Dr. Praveen. So, when I heard about the madam's talk, I felt that I am attending the final year or fourth year MBBS student regarding the pit of malnutrition and all. So thank you, madam, for your information. And I start with thanking the IAP faculties, IAP office bearers, the trio. Again, I am using the same word as madam used, Dr. Priya, Dr. Praveen, and Dr. Bennett. Also, Dr. Riaz, for giving me this opportunity to talk before you. My talk for presentation is bronchiolitis in children. So I will start with why this topic is relevant for the time. Bronchiolitis is one of the most common cause of hospitalization due to lower respiratory tract infection in infants. And there are so many treatment options available. Most of them are ineffective and treatment costs become very high. And AAP and NICE guidelines has published in 2014 and 2015 and made the diagnosis and treatment very rational. So they have also modified the recommendation in 2019. So we should go through this. That's why this topic is selected, I think. So coming to bronchiolitis, it is an acute viral lower respiratory tract illness occurring in children less than 2 years, characterized by acute wheezing, hyperinflation, tachypnea due to acute inflammation of the airways. As you all know, the cause is only viral. Very rarely only some bacterial cause occurs in the form of Mycoplasma pneumonia or chlamydia. So one of the studies published in Indian literature shows that
screen share here, sir.
Onilla screen varunilla.
സ്ക്രീൻ
സ്ക്രീൻസ് പോസ്റ്റ് എന്ന് കാണിക്കുന്നു
സർ ആ ഗ്രീൻ ഒരു ഷെയർ സ്ക്രീൻ ഒരു ബട്ടൺ ഇല്ലേ സർ
ആ അതിനകത്തുണ്ട് എല്ലാത്തെ കാണിക്കുന്നത്
സാർ ആ സ്ക്രീൻ ഷെയർ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട് പക്ഷേ പ്രസന്റേഷൻ ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്തിട്ടില്ല
സ്ക്രീൻ ഷെയറിംഗ് ഇസ് പോസ്റ്റ് എന്ന് കാണിക്കുന്നു
സർ അതൊന്നും കൂടെ ക്ലോസ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഒന്നും കൂടെ ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്യോ സർ
ഒന്ന് ക്ലോസ് ചെയ്ത് തുടങ്ങാനാ
അതെ ആ സ്ക്രീൻ ഷെയറിംഗ് ഒന്ന് ഓഫ് ചെയ്ത് ഒന്നും കൂടെ
ടോപ്പ് ഷെയർ കൊടുത്തിട്ട് വീണ്ടും ഒന്നും കൂടി കാണിച്ചു
bronchiolitis is an acute viral lower respiratory tract illness occurring in
സാറിന്റെ കണക്ഷൻ പോയെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു നമുക്ക് മാഡത്തിന്റെ അടുത്ത് ഡൗട്ട്സ് ചോദിക്കേണ്ടത് ചോദിക്കാം അല്ലെ
ഐ തിങ്ക് വി ഹാവ് ലോസ്റ്റ് കണക്ഷൻ വിത്ത് ഷാൻവ സർ വി കാൻ യൂട്ടിലൈസ് ദിസ് ടൈം ഫോർ ആസ്കിംഗ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ടു മാഡം എലിസബത്ത് മാഡം ആർ യു ദേർ പ്ലീസ് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് എലിസബത്ത് മാഡം
യെസ് സർ
ഹലോ എലിസബത്ത് മാഡം ഉണ്ടോ ഹലോ മാഡം ശരിയായോ റിയാസ് കേക്കാമോ കേക്കാമോ ഇവിടെ
കേക്കുന്നുണ്ട് പക്ഷെ എലിസബത്ത് മാഡത്തിന് കിട്ടുന്നില്ല ഞാനൊന്ന് നോക്കട്ടെ
മറ്റേ ടോക്കും പ്രശ്നമായല്ലേ ഇപ്പം
ടോക്ക് എനിക്കൊന്ന് സാറിന്റെ കണക്ഷൻ പോയതാ ഒന്നുകൂടെ നോക്കാം ഞാൻ സാറിനെ വിളിക്കാം ഹലോ സർ, ഹലോ ഷാന സർ, കേക്കാമോ?
ഹലോ, കേക്കാമോ?
കേക്കാം കേക്കാം സർ,
കാണാമോ? കാണാമോ?
കാണാം
കാണാം. പറഞ്ഞാ മതിയാ?
പറഞ്ഞാ മതി, പറഞ്ഞാ മതി.
Okay, so sorry for the inconveniences. So I will again start with the etiology. As you all know, bronchiolitis is the most common cause is virus. The most common virus is respiratory syncytial virus, account for about 60-65% of patients, and followed by parainfluenza virus, enterovirus, adenovirus, and the latest addition in this group include human metapneumovirus and Boca virus. Our notorious coronavirus, as you all know, the forefather of novel coronavirus, is also a cause of bronchiolitis. So this the most common age group is 80% of time it is less than 1 year, and mostly less than 6 months. Boys outnumbers girls by 1.5 times. What are the risk factors of bronchiolitis? A poor socioeconomic group, exposure to tobacco smoke and other environmental smoke, and lack of breastfeeding. Madam has already highlighted the importance of breastfeeding. A lack of breastfeeding and a contact with an young child who is having, and URA, repeatedly having URA, a child who is going to school, he will come with URA and give to the younger child, and child attending daycare center. These are the high risk factors for development of bronchiolitis. What are the high risk factors of severe bronchiolitis? Prematurity, especially age less than 32 weeks at birth, or those babies who are having chronic lung disease, low birth weight, cardiac disease in the form, severe cardiac disease in the form, left to right shunt, or cyanotic congenital heart disease, and congenital and immune deficiency and genetic disorders, or if any of these are present, these babies are more prone to develop severe bronchiolitis. So what is the pathogenesis of bronchiolitis? The bronchiolitis affects mainly beyond terminal bronchioles and beyond. So there is inflammation and inflammation of the epithelium that leads to edema and mucus production and sloughing of the epithelium. This sloughing produces obstruction of the medium and small bronchioles. If it is cut completely or obstructed, it will produce atelectasis. A partial check valve obstruction leads to air trapping and hyperinflation. So for diagnosis of bronchiolitis, there is nothing else is needed, only history and clinical examination. So how you will proceed with the history? History usually in children less than 1 year, they usually start as an upper respiratory tract infection. After 2 to 3 days, they will go for cough and difficulty in breathing, and respiratory distress is the main presenting symptom. And one of the family member will have a URA. Any child less than 1 year who is coming with cough and difficulty in breathing for the first day, you should suspect bronchiolitis. Fever is not a major manifestation in routine bronchiolitis, especially with the RSV. And it is very commonly seen in case of adenoviral bronchiolitis. When it advances, there will be poor feeding, and sensorial changes like drowsiness can also occur. On examination, there can be tachypnea, tachycardia, and on inspection of the chest, you can have chest retraction with the grand flaring of LNSA. The hyper resonance chest on percussion, and on auscultation, there will be prolonged expiration, wheezing, and crackles. A palpable liver and spleen, it is due to push down from the hyperexpanded chest. A fluctuating physical examination finding is one of the common finding. So you examine now, there will be symptoms and sign. After some time, everything will disappear and reappear after some time. That is another clinical feature of bronchiolitis. So there is a clinical grading for bronchiolitis depending on the ability to feed, respiratory effort, and oxygen saturation. If the patient is able to feed normally, and there is mild or little respiratory distress, and SpO2 is more than 92% in room air, it is mild bronchiolitis. And if there is shortness of breath during feeding and moderate respiratory distress characterized by a chest retraction, nasal flaring, and SpO2 less than 92% correctable by oxygen administration, it is moderate bronchiolitis. And inability to feed, marked respiratory distress with the retraction, grunt, and flaring, and SpO2 less than 92% not correct even with oxygen administration, it is severe bronchiolitis. So what are the complications of bronchiolitis? Apnea and respiratory failure are the most dangerous and serious complication. It is more commonly seen in preterm babies and those children less than 3 months. otitis media due to same virus or bacteria or both can also. Dehydration, it is mainly due to inability to take fluids and also due to water loss during rapid breathing. Aspiration pneumonia can also happen. Secondary pneumonia, it is very rare in bronchiolitis, but it is often the reason for starting antibiotics most of us. So what is the clinical course of bronchiolitis? It's usually start as URA and lasts for 1 to 2 weeks. Average duration of hospitalization is 3 to 7 days. But radiological clearance of atelectasis takes longer time. When there is more than one viral infection occur, it can produce severe bronchiolitis. Coming to lab testing, American Academy of Pediatrics does not recommend any investigation in the first episode of bronchiolitis in a healthy child. Test of viral identification is also not recommended. It is recommended in patients in case of research purposes, and also if you want to rule out an H1N1 associated bronchiolitis, you can do a viral identification test. Pulse oximetry has improved the outcome very much, but it is associated, the disadvantage of pulse oximetry is it is associated with the lower threshold of hospitalization, ICU admission, and mechanical ventilation. Coming to X-ray, there is no indication for routine X-ray in a case of bronchiolitis. X-ray is indicated when there is doubt regarding diagnosis. A rapid progression, unlike that of routine bronchiolitis, no improvement. Even after 1 week, if it is not improved, or comorbidities like low birth weight, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, or other comorbidities there, you can take an X-ray. All patients admitting into an ICU should have an X-ray. So that's an indication for X-ray in a case of bronchiolitis. So X-ray will show increased bronchovascular marking radiating from the hilum, and there may be scattered areas of atelectasis. Again, those babies who are undergoing X-ray, as in any patient with RTA, respiratory tract infection, who are undergoing an X-ray, we will over-treat them with antibiotics, because there is some similarity. We will over-diagnose bronchiolitis in a case of X-ray. So as far as possible, don't go for an X-ray. So the close differential diagnosis of bronchiolitis is pneumonia. When will you suspect pneumonia? If there is high fever, persistent focal crackle, and CBC and CRP, elevated CRP and CBC showing a polymorphonuclear leukocytosis, you can consider the diagnosis of bronchiolitis. And consider diagnosis of pneumonia. So second differential diagnosis, a viral disease. Is it an onset of a first episode viral induced wheeze? So if there is persistent wheeze without much crackles, you can suspect a first episode wheeze. So also a past history of similar episode, you should suspect a viral induced wheeze. A personal history, a family history of atopy or asthma, it could be due to a viral induced wheeze. So what are the indications for hospitalization in a case of bronchiolitis? If the respiratory is more than 60 per minute, difficulty or inability of breastfeeding, oral fluid intake of only up to 50 to 70% of usual volume, when there is a high risk factor in the form of age less than 3 months, chronic lung disease, congenital heart disease, or low birth weight is there, those babies should be admitted. And a clinical evidence of dehydration is also another indication for hospitalization. When you admit a child straight into ICU, when there is evidence of impending respiratory failure, as evidenced by signs of exhaustion in the form of decreased respiratory effort, listlessness, recurrent apnea, failure to maintain SpO2 with oxygen administration, and central cyanosis. So the list of management is very long. So respiratory support, fluid therapy, bronchodilators, hypertonic saline, like that. So we'll go take one by one whether it can be used in bronchiolitis or not. Coming to respiratory support. So a routine nasal suction deep into the nose or throat is not at all indicated. It is indicated when there is a documented apnea or a history of apnea. But you can have a secretion within the nose. If it is, you know, nose is filled with the secretion, you can suck it up. But no deep nasal suction in case of bronchiolitis. Do not carry out ABG except in case of impending respiratory failure or the requirement of FiO2 is more than 0.5. So the oxygen, the main treatment option is humidified oxygen. So according to different recommendation, there are different SpO2 level by which you at that level you should start oxygen. In case of AAP, American Academy of Medicine, they recommend 90% saturation in room air to start oxygen. And in case of NICE guidelines, 92. In some of the IAP recommendation is 94% saturation to start. If it is coming less than that, you should start anaerobes. Nowadays, high flow oxygen using a HFNC, a high flow heated humidified cannula, has improved the outcome of bronchiolitis, and it avoid the use of CPAP and also ventilator in a patient bronchiolitis. So in case of more severe respiratory disorder, you can start high flow oxygen. Consider CPAP in an impending respiratory failure. And what are the indications for mechanical ventilation in case of bronchiolitis? A clinical deterioration in CPAP or apnea and recurrent apnea, bradycardia, hypercarbia, and ABG. These are the indication for mechanical ventilation in case of bronchiolitis. So chest physiotherapy, a clinician should not use chest physiotherapy for infants and children with the diagnosis of bronchiolitis unless there is some problem in the form of muscular disorders where there is inability to spit out sputum. Fluid therapy. So nasogastric or orogastric tube feed is indicated if the child is unable to take enough fluid by mouth. So intravenous fluid therapy is indicated where tube feeds fails impending respiratory failure. Beware, this is a condition where there is SAADH is very common, and you should start 2/3 of maintenance fluid. The other 2 isotonic fluid should be given. What is the role of beta 2 agonist? The beta 2 agonist studied are receiving adrenaline and also salbutamol. AAP does not recommend routine use of bronchodilators in the management of bronchiolitis. A meta-analysis involving 19 trials with 2 to 5, 6 children have shown that bronchodilator neither treats hypoxemia nor affect the progress of bronchiolitis. So when you start a trial of bronchodilators, a child with history of atopy, a family history of atopy or asthma, and and also a child with predominant osculated finding of this. If these findings are present in a child present with bronchiolitis, you can give a test dose of bronchodilators as a nebulization and look for the response. If the response is good, you can continue. Otherwise, you should not continue bronchodilators. Role of steroids. Clinician should not administer systemic corticosteroids to infants with diagnosis of bronchiolitis in any setting, in any form. This is the recommendation given by the IAP. So it does not decrease the severity of illness, duration of hospitalization, but it increases the viral shedding. So with a good quality of evidence of air and a good with a strong recommendation, AAP, NICE, and LAAP, all guidelines strongly recommend against use of steroids. The role of hypertonic saline. So nebulous hypertonic saline should not be used in infants with a diagnosis of bronchiolitis in an emergency department. Here also, the recommendation has got a big quality of evidence and moderate recommendation. But you can use this in an hospitalized child. So in a hospital child, if you use nebulized hypertonic saline, it will decrease the duration of hospitalization. Then what are the things that hypertonic saline will do? It decreases the epithelial edema, improves the elasticity and viscosity of mucus, and improves the airway clearance. So hypertonic saline can be used in hospital children with bronchiolitis. Role of antibiotics, as we all know, clinicians should not administer antibacterial medications to infants and children with a diagnosis of bronchiolitis unless there is a concomitant bacterial infection or a strong suspicion of one. Antiviral drugs. The routine use of antiviral drugs like ribavirin, palivizumab, RSV immunoglobulin is not indicated in healthy, uncomplicated bronchiolitis. In a Cochrane review with 320 children showed that aerosolized ribavirin is beneficial in children with high risk for developing severe bronchiolitis. So what is the role of palivizumab? What is palivizumab? Palivizumab is a humanized mouse IgG1 monoclonal antibody directed against site A and F glycoprotein of RSV. It blocks the fusion of virus to the host epithelial cells. So if you use it, reduces the RSV infection associated hospitalization in high-risk infants, but does not reduce mortality rates. But prophylactic administration of palivizumab have failed to show savings. So the cost is too much. So it will not have any savings if you use palivizumab in bronchiolitis. So the indication that AAP recommends given are children less than 24 months of age with the CLD who have required medical therapy for CLD within 6 months before the start of RSV season. Infants born at 28 weeks of gestation or earlier, who are younger than 12 months of age at the start of RSV season for infants 29 to 32 weeks at gestation who are younger than 6 months of age to start of RSV season, and infants 32 to 35 weeks of gestation with more than 2 risk in the form of child care attendance, school age sibling, exposure to environmental air pollutants, and congenital abnormalities of airway and severe neuromuscular disease are the indication for starting paroxysmal. So when you discharge a patient with bronchiolitis, the discharge criteria are a clinically stable child who is taking adequate fluid and maintaining more than 92% of oxygen in air for more than 4 hours, including during sleep, you can discharge that patient safely. But you should give proper advice regarding discharge. So when they should come back, the red flag signs are increase of Burkholm breathing and fluid intake of less than 50 to 70% of normal, no wet nappy in 12 hours, apnea or cyanosis, exhaustion. You should teach all these danger signs to the parent and to the parents before discharging the child. So, and they should be advised to avoid smoking home and encourage breastfeeding. So how will you prevent bronchiolitis? So we are all in hand washing and social distancing era now. So all patient people should be disinfect their hands before and after direct contact with patient, and after contact with any inanimate objects in the direct vicinity of the patient, and after removing gloves. And all people should use alcohol-based rubs for hand decontamination when caring for children with bronchiolitis. When alcohol-based rubs are not available, hand wash. The same as that of our novel coronavirus prevention. So what is the relationship between bronchiolitis and asthma? So 30 to 50% of patients hospitalized for bronchiolitis develop recurrent wheezing, especially less than 2 to 3 years. So and they overcome the effect of bronchiolitis and bronchoconstriction by 10 years. And they are permanent by history. It is diagnosed by history and clinical examination. There is no need for any investigation in standard bronchiolitis. Respiratory support with oxygen, CPAP, and proper hydration are the main mode of therapy. These are the three main modes. Oxygen by any way, CPAP in indicated patients, proper hydration in almost all patients are the main modes of therapy. Evidence-based medicine did not support the use of bronchodilators, steroids, hypertonic saline, or antibiotics in bronchiolitis. Thank you for the hearing, and very sorry for the interruption in between.
Thank you, sir, for the very informative talk. We have a few questions to Elizabeth Madam here. Madam, I'll read out the questions to you. The first question is from Dr. Bennett. What are the current guidelines of breastfeeding? Is lying posture permitted? Elizabeth Madam. Praveen, can you unmute Elizabeth Madam? Dr. Praveen, please unmute Elizabeth Madam. The first question is, Madam, is lying posture during breastfeeding permitted according to the current guidelines?
We are following the BFHI guidelines. Every step we are following. But in Kerala, the advice given was that lying down, nobody should breastfeed. And that was not according to the BFHI guidelines. I showed the BFHI 2018 pictures. These pictures are taken from the WHO module only. So they were permitting the lying down posture. And I'm sure that many mothers are doing it successfully. And in one situation, as a solution, out of the box solution, we are recommending the lying down posture. Lying down posture may not be advisable to everybody because of the mother may be sleeping or sleeping over the baby, chance for SIDS and all. But if a mother has a problem, she can choose this issue.
ഡിസ്കഷൻ വേണം വേണോ എന്ന് തോന്നിയിട്ടാണ് ഈ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഇട്ടത്. കാരണം കഴിഞ്ഞ ഒരു ടോപ്പിക് ഡിസ്കഷനിൽ ഈ ഒരു കൺഫ്യൂഷൻ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. കാരണം ഇതിന് അക്കോർഡിംഗ് ടു BFHI ലൈംഗ് പോസ്റ്റർ ഈസ് ഓൾവേസ് പെർമിറ്റഡ് ഇഫ് ദ അതിൽ ഒറ്റ പോയിന്റ് ആണ് പ്രധാനമായിട്ട് പറയുന്നത്. ഇഫ് മദർ ആൻഡ് ചൈൽഡ് ഈസ് കംഫർട്ടബിൾ വാട്ട് ഓർ മേ ബി ദ പൊസിഷൻ യു ക്യാൻ ഗിവ്. അതാണ് മാഡത്തിന്റെ ടീച്ചിങ് എപ്പോഴും നമ്മൾ കേൾക്കുന്നത്. പക്ഷെ ഇടയ്ക്കിടയ്ക്കുള്ള ഈ വേറെ ടോക്കുകളൊക്കെ വന്നപ്പോഴേ അതിൽ നിന്ന് വ്യത്യസ്തമായിട്ട് ഒള്ളി ഇൻ സിറ്റിംഗ് പോസ്റ്റർ എന്ന് വന്നതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഈ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഞാൻ ഇട്ടത്. For the information to everybody.
Not feasible. No mother. We are all mothers. It is not always possible to sit up and feed. Because the feeding happens 24 hours, different postures, different timings, it is happening. So from if the mother, we must check whether the mother can be advised. If she understands, and if she is having the depression or she is not listening, or the parents are telling she is not taking care of the baby, we should not permit that. But as an out of the box solution, this is possible, and those pictures are from the BFHI 2018.
Next question is from Dr. Balachandran. NNF Foxy says that the second swab of newborn should be taken between 5 to 14 days. Is it logical?
I think that that guideline is being followed. When a baby is born to a COVID mother, that is 14 days before delivery to 28 days, during that period, if the mother is found to be COVID, the baby is, neonate is a COVID suspect. And any COVID suspect will have to undergo the swab. So the swab is taken, and if the mother is still positive, I said the mother is in isolation, then EBM is given. If the baby is also positive or the mother is negative and became negative later and the baby is also negative, we permit them to have the direct. It is being done because the baby is now a COVID suspect neonate. It is said that 14 days before delivery or 28 days during the neonatal period, if the mother is positive or any caretaker or any person who is taking care, including the doctor, is positive, the baby becomes a suspect, and any suspect will have to have the swab.
Okay, madam. The next
guideline, these are live documents, it may change.
The next question is from Dr. Jesslyn. Which oil has to be applied over cracked nipple?
We always recommend only coconut oil.
Dr. Manjali.
It is very acceptable to our custom, and every family, everywhere it is available. Even for rubbing the baby, coconut oil is used in our culture.
Question from Dr. Manjusha. Is nipple shield useful in retracted nipple? Will it cause nipple confusion for the baby?
Sure, it will cause. But we may sometimes temporarily use it. And I had a mother who was using the nipple shield. I counseled her. Maybe at 7 o'clock, I send her. By 9 o'clock, I had a call telling that I removed my nipple shield. So counseling, she could do it. So that can be removed easily, but it will cause nipple confusion.
Can egg be given at 8 months?
Yes, in Western world, up 6 months, they start chicken soup and everything. Only in our culture, we say that initially let us go for the cereal pulse, vegetables and fruits, and then. But any item before taste buds are formed, we have to introduce if we are really bending on that the baby should take it. For example, a spread of 100 items are there. All of us may go to the tapioca and the fish curry. But our children may not go because they never had the chance to take it before their taste buds were made or something like that.
When is the ideal time to start giving meat?
That is what I said. In the Western world, after 6 months, they start. But here we say 6 to 7 months, we will give the vegetarian items. Then 7 to 8 months or later, anytime we can start. But the chances of accepting for a lifetime will be better if you start before the taste buds are developed. Otherwise, they will develop likes and dislikes.
Another question is, if a child is, a baby started on boil, they get 8 to 9 months and develops vomiting and diarrhea when given egg, is there any other solution to continue giving egg in any other form?
So that question is little tricky. Boiled egg means they are introducing the white and the yolk together. That is not acceptable, because egg white is the protein which may, there may be allergy. So we have to give the egg yolk. Even when we take the yolk, there may be little contamination of the white. So a baby who has intolerance or allergy may start vomiting. And one vomiting may be just by accident, so we have to give it again. But if the baby develops urticaria or anaphylaxis, then we cannot. But by and large, milk allergy, egg allergy will go away by school age. Earlier the allergy comes, earlier they will come out of that. For example, a very young infant has bloody diarrhea because of cow's milk protein allergy. They will get over it earlier. And but the tree nuts, the peanut, the seafood is going to stay with you.
Another question is, madam, a 9-month baby with 16 kg weight on complementary feeds and breastfeeding, does he need evaluation?
Definitely, because we expect by 9 months, we say birth weight should triple, 9 kilo. Most of the babies have 8 to 9 kilo, and this is double that, 200% increase. And here we would, I would like to know what is the length of the baby. If the baby's length is more, that is because of the over, that is the, there is the imbalance between the energy going in and the energy which is utilized. But if the baby's length is small, maybe it is a, who knows whether it is an adrenal tumor or something like that. So definitely evaluation is needed.
Is rooming in and feeding the child by a COVID method desirable?
Once again?
Rooming in and feeding the child of a COVID mother, is it desirable?
That is what? Breastfeeding, I said, express breast milk will be given if the mother needs isolation. Otherwise, it is rooming in. But we check the baby's swabs also. And she, mother has to take all the precautions, N95 mask, and that all precautions as a doctor who is doing procedures. That is it. So, but if the if she is not febrile for 72 hours, if she if her respiratory symptoms are not gone, or her two swabs are negative, she has to be in isolation. Then, if the baby is a COVID suspect, we will do the swab, wait for the report. And then rooming in cannot be practiced at that point of time.
Another question is, madam, is there any guideline as per which we can start cow's milk?
The AAP guideline says animal milk should be started after 1 year of age, because asthma, allergy, all are very common in the Western world, more than our place. But the NIN, the National Institute of Nutrition guideline says that our children, the mothers are stopping breast milk abruptly after 6 months. Once they start, many mothers are doing it because of their pressures of work or work pressure or something. They are stopping and going for the very very thin gruel, which I said, 30 kilocalories per 100 ml to that. And then NIN is telling that malnutrition, stunting, wasting is too much in this age. So we can advise milk protein as a source of protein. Milk can be added after 6 months. But as a professional, we must say that get the history if there is atopy, allergy in the family or in the child, better to wait, go by the AAP guideline.
Okay, madam. Now there's one question for Shanawas, sir. Shanawas, sir, are you there? By the time sir comes, madam, one more question. Is there any solution to constipation induced by formula feeds?
Actually, constipation and infrequent passage of stool should be differentiated. These days, I am seeing a lot of babies, 3 to 4 months old, rapid weight gain, that is their weight from 3 kg has already doubled. We say 4 months or 5 months it will double, but by 2.5 to 3 months they double, and they have infrequent passage of stool. So most of the time it is a semi-solid stool without any difficulty it comes, but it doesn't come every day. So 3 per day to 3 per week may be normal at that age. So we have to find out. But constipation means it is very dry, it is too big, or it is like pellets. So if it is coming like pellets, it is sausage, big sausage like, and very dry, and baby is having real difficulty in passing it, that is constipation. So we have to find out that. And we know that artificial feeding, the energy is the same, 67 or 70 calories per 100 ml. But if so, we cannot tell them to dilute. And if we give a mandate to dilute, they will dilute to their fancy. 2 times water, 3 times water, they will add. So we cannot permit that. But knowing that the solute load is more, and there is chance, there is increased water demand for the baby. So we'll have to tackle that. Maybe breast milk in between, or some way of giving some more fluid to the baby, we may have to think. And of course, we should rule out the hypothyroidism and other causes of constipation.
Thank you, madam. Now, Praveen, can you unmute Shanawas, sir?
If that is...
Madam, you can continue.
If that is taking a little time, I want to tell you one more. Usually what mothers ask, can I give biscuit as the complementary food? And the term complementary feeding is to complement breast milk with natural products. That is training the baby to the texture and the natural way of giving it. Even fruit juice in the JUNCS guideline, IAP has said that fruit juice should not be given below 2 years, because we will be, the texture is gone. It is now a different product, and we will be adding sugar to that. We don't want that. And so whether biscuits can be given to the baby it is a popular complementary food among middle class and most of the, but in the JUNCS, J-U-N-C-S, and the, what is the biscuit is a, that is a processed food. Ultra processed food is considered as a junk food. Why? Because the original, say from sugar cane and table sugar are so different. That is, it is processed to increase the shelf life and the acceptability. But then the natural, the components are lost in that, and we may be bleaching it, or in the we may be adding trans fat, which has got lot of shelf life. If you buy a snack, it says it will stay for a month. That means there is trans fat. Nothing else will stay like that. So we are not recommending it. But sometimes for life, nothing else can be offered. We'll have to accept that. But it is not a recommendation.
Madam, another question from Dr. Wahida. Many babies are brought with diarrhea when the mother is fasting. What could be the reason?
What to?
Many babies are brought with diarrhea when the mother is fasting. I think it's Ramzan fasting what she is meaning. What could be the reason of that?
I have not come across any baby like that. Maybe it is a new phenomenon. All of us are going to see. Thank you, Dr. Wahida, for bringing it out. And I think hunger stools are there. We have studied in Kwashiorkor. No, they pass passage of mucus. Hunger stools we used to call it. Maybe it is not diarrhea. Maybe just hunger stools which is coming. So we'll have to take a detailed history and see.
Madam, what is the time when you can start giving water to the baby? And is there any recommendation for the quantity to be given?
The fluid requirement, we have the recommendation. No, the Holiday and Cigar formula that we use, we can use. But including the milk and the breast milk, the formula milk, and the rest only water. After starting the complementary feeding, mostly we may be giving little water so that the mouth becomes clean also. That is it.
Okay, madam. Praveen, can you unmute Shanawas sir now? Shanawas sir, there's a question. What is the logic behind not giving hypertonic saline nebulization in the ER? Why only when the child is IP?
This is depending on the studies they have done. They have done meta-analysis of various studies and found that if you give the nebulization in ER, there is no decrease in hospitalization. The chance of admission into ICU didn't decrease. And so also there is no other changes. That's why the recommendation of AAP and NICE, they said there is no. But even then, other studies are saying that you can use in ER also. But most of the studies, the meta-analysis doesn't really reveal any evidence for decrease in hospitalization rate or decrease in intensity like that. So that's why they are advised against ER nebulization. That is depending on the study.
Again, one question for Elizabeth, madam. Elizabeth, madam, are you there? A question for Elizabeth, madam.
Unmuted.
Praveen, please unmute Elizabeth, madam.
Yes.
Madam, the question is, what is your take on oramarina given to young infants? Is it safe? Is there any significant adverse effect?
I don't know the components of oramarina, and we have never prescribed it, but it is a traditional practice. And I must say that it is like the pre-lacteal feed only. Maybe it has got some carminative properties, but burping and all is only what we recommend. And many babies are doing good without the oramarina. So, but you must be careful that when you give the oramarina, a lot of contamination can occur. And way back, maybe 3 decades back, I have seen a baby 2.5 to 3 months old vomiting around. So we were so surprised. And then Raman sir was with us when he said, what is the life cycle from worm, from egg to adult, the of a roundworm? It is 2.5 to 3 months. So sir was telling this, so roundworm was given by the granny on day one along with the pre-lacteal.
To add one point on that,
Yes, sir, please.
So nowadays it is available from hospitals, from pharmacy itself, as tablets, this oramarina. So we had 2 patients recently. One patient came with seizure, and another patient came with SVT. So we analyzed the drug. It was found out to finally end up to digoxin tablet. It was mistakenly given as
oramarina.
The other one had seizure, frank seizure, but we couldn't do the chemical analysis. So it is so many patients with gastritis because they are giving in the concentration.
Which pharmacy will give oramarina was prescribed?
Madam, it was the mother. It was given from the pharmacy. They are saying they bought from pharmacy.
Outside pharmacy, maybe.
Outside
pharmacy. Any more questions? I would like to thank both the speakers for the excellent presentation and for the very lucid and clear talk. I think everybody would agree with me. Now, I think we have our state president, Dr. Narayanan, with us. Sir, would you like to comment on today's meeting? Praveen, can you unmute Narayanan, sir, and Bala, sir?
Dr. Bala had left.
Yeah. Yeah, good evening to you all. It was very nice hearing madam, my teacher, when I was doing DCH in 1989-90 at SIT Hospital. And the same way she was teaching that time also. With the same voice, same tone and all. So it's a, when I'm hearing her from around right now, a feeling of nostalgia. And three things. One is that, three things that Madam has told. One is writing the, noting the time of starting of breastfeeding in the newborn bed. That will be very important. I think IAP has to take it, and at different forums we will discuss it, and it should be implemented. If the NNF agrees with NNF, that will be a very good sign. When we were doing post-graduation, there was a, in certain, some medical colleges, there was a time when a meningitis child comes, the time we are starting crystalline penicillin. From the time of attendance in the casualty to that duration, that was very important, because you should start CP at the earliest. The time duration was taken into consideration. Similarly, this is also very important, time duration between the delivery and the initiation of breastfeeding, that we should take. And second thing is that now, as per the government immunization schedule, babies are not seen from 3 months to, oh, say, 9 months, that also. But in private practice, we are seeing there's a hepatitis B vaccine. So 6 months, we are calling them back. It is just for the nutritional assessment, that will help in nutritional assessment. So if you are giving the third dose instead of Pentavac, if you are giving something like Cordavax, then they can come for hepatitis B vaccine. And you can right now, as it is required, we can do is influenza vaccine also. Those two things, definitely, I think we should, in your practice, we can implement. And third one, actually, it's a IAP action plan, right diet for the child. So it's an important part of the madam has started how to give the right diet from in infancy. So it's a very, very helpful to the action plan of IAP Kerala. And regarding the BFHI, we had actually started, we have been continuing the BFHI program that has started in revamping of BFHI, just started in 2019, we were continuing, but due to some problems, we could not continue the field work and lactation training was done. So somehow we will be continuing the that also with NNF. So overall, sir, it was a very good talk. I congratulate Madam and IAP Trivandrum for the wonderful session you have presented. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. I think Dr. Priya is on duty and she has left. So I would like to ask Dr. Riyaz to round up today's Zoom session.
It was, as always, it was a very wonderful talk from Elizabeth Madam, because every time there is an extra point, the same topic when Madam is discussing. So all of us are happy to hear you again and again, Madam. And Shanava sir, for Trivandrum students and for all of us, he is a little away from us now, but it's a pleasure to hear you, sir, again, even from a distance. I think sir is also on duty at Alipi, and that was the problem of his disturbances. Thank you. Thank you, both of you. And thanks, Dr. Narayanan, for attending IAP Zoom, Trivandrum Zoom, every week. I think you are a regular in all the meetings in your busy schedule. And thanks, all the delegates. The house was full almost all the time. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye. Thank you, Dr. Riyaz. I would like to thank everybody who have attended today's meeting. And I would also tell you that we'll be coming again soon with another interesting session next week. Thank you and good night. Thank you.